So, Mr. Harrington, could you state for the camera your name and the years you attended Linda McKinley High School? How old were you in 71 and what grade were you in?
My name is John Allen Harrington. I'm gonna put the Allen in there also. Actually named after my grandfather. And I attended Linda McKinley High School, 69, 70, graduated 1971. So I attended all 3 years of high school before there was serious change of intermixing. You know, it was 3 years of high school and now they done changed a few things and it's middle school, high school and all that. So I'm from the original time, you know, where the younger generation still calls us OGs or whatever, but it was during a time where you only had 3 years of high school.
And so in 71, how old were you?
I was 17 years of age when I graduated. Born in July, I graduated at 17, just before I turned 18.
Okay. Can you talk to us about what Linden, what the community was like when you were a young a teenager there, when you were in high school? And also, was there racial tension in the community or in the school, both or neither? What was that like?
What's the first question?
What was the community like, Linden? What was it like?
The community was going from being dominated by whites as they moved to the suburbs. And as we moved in from the east side to Mount Vernon area, we started dominating the neighborhood. You know, they move out, we move in. And, you know, that seems to be, you know, the system way. The community was very clean. A lot of involvement, you know, with parents. During that time, if someone said to me growing up, I had to listen to them because they were an adult. So leadership came in a lot of different directions from us, as we were children, from our parents to their friends to pastors of churches to strong leaders, just something that we did during that time. Seems like a lot of that needs to be able to be returned for the days that we are moving forward into. But that's the way it was for me. My parents, I had to listen to, I had to be obedient. Everything was yes, sir, and yes, ma'am. It wasn't no calling them by first name or being disrespectful the way some of these children are today. Lack of profanity, I never heard my parents cuss. And when my dad did, he used different words like sugar, honey, things like that. But we understood where he was going. So to tone things out, you were obedient as children. And
so,
that was just the way of life for us. Like I'm saying, you know, I grew up with a lot of friends and it didn't matter what location we hung out in, we did things a little different. We're always gonna be mischievous, because that's the way children are growing up, but it was still a matter of that we knew our limits and never stepped beyond them.
So with that, with the changes that were happening in Linden, you know, what I'm hearing from you was that the black community was close-knit and was cohesive. But with the changes that were happening, did that shift from being majority white to majority black, did it cause tension in the neighborhood, in the school? Because I imagine as the community changed, the school changed.
Yes, with the community changing, I would say that there was some tension. I believe tension is going to always be there when you interact with different races. It just seems to be the nature of the beast. But it wasn't a violent type. It was more attitude than anything else. It was of a different choice of words. You know, even though we heard the N-word, you know, we would use the, you know, okay, cracker, or whatever. You know, we'd fight back with words more than a a violent reaction until maybe they stepped across a certain line that would always take us there. Because by nature, we are calm and a very loving and heartful given race of people. For some reason, we're that way until taken out of our character. That's when we will change.
So with that, can you talk about, you know, were you aware of political and social turmoil that was happening in the country at large? And if you were, did that affect you? If it affected you, how did it affect you?
Well, yeah, there was turmoil in the country because we grew up during a time of one by force, Malcolm X, one by love, Martin Luther King. So we had a choice of courage and leadership, whether you wanted to turn the other cheek or whether you wanted to hit the other cheek. So you can be somewhere either one side or the opposite side, but the two sides still would come together because they stood for equal rights. They wanted everything to be civil for not just the light-skinned people. They wanted change for us as black-skinned people to make everything even, equal. And we still a long way from that today. And they pacify us, you know. It's like giving us one of them suckers that our kids like to put on their finger and suck on. That's the systematic that they seem to have in their mental thinking, that if we pacify them, we calm them down. They want uproar. They will be settled. We'll give them a larger piece of the ham, but we ain't gonna put the bone in the middle of it for them to suck on it. So this is the mentality that we have to be able to realize and figure out how to get around that, manipulate, and end up with life the way that it was meant to be. But we a long way from that real dream, and I got a dream of reality, and black and white kids are gonna hold hands and love one another. It's a wonderful thought, but I'm not sure the reality of it will eventually happen. Even today, even with what goes on, they're streamlining more for us behind what happened in the killings, but they've been killing and hanging us for years.
So back at that time, when you saw different things that were happening, you know, events that were happening, assassinations that were happening, mm-hmm. You know, protesters and demonstrators being brutalized, when you saw those things, what were your thoughts and how did it affect you? How did you relate it to your life at all?
Well, seeing assassinations, you always wonder why us? We are the most assassinated people, race of people that this happens to, because our leaders have strong courage. They're not afraid to step out, and then the mass will follow. That's the way it is. And when you have a man or a female that will stand out and be the front row, it's a threat. You become a threat. You become someone that, whether you calm or violent, you are a threat to their, what they feel is their superior order of being, because they already feel that they're a superior race and they're not willing to recognize any other color as far as the leadership role or who's the smartest in the world, who develops everything. But when you go back and look at your history, it's all racist. God put us down here for different reasons, and you have different cultures and you have different input on what he wants for this earth. But certain people, they just want to remove all that and control it all. But as far as the community and Columbus, Ohio, back in 69, 70, 71, there was a lot of turmoil just in the school system, period. It just wasn't riots at Lyndon McKinley. We had uproars at all high schools. When you go back and read the articles that the Dispatch wrote, it was turmoil for all of us. Black and white students, parents, communities all around us. Eastmore Junior High, Central High School, East High, we all had our incidents, but the biggest incident that affected the city more than the rest of them, and where the parents would also come together and kind of support us, even though some of them had attitudes, didn't believe that what we were doing was right, it was right here at home at Linda McKinley, where I grew up. So it's just a thing that you have to have a mindset to be able to deal, if you're brought up in the right meaning by your parents, because I had both parents at home. And my dad is still the backbone winner and the leader of my house I grew up in. But whatever my mom said, we better follow. And I think that was the structure back then for children, to have that strong man figure for leadership. And in that role of leadership, it was still, you gotta be a man. You gotta stand up for your rights, you gotta stand up for your beliefs, and you can't let anybody deteriorate that or make you change it. You just can't, and be a person. Because at the end of the day, you have to be able to go home and live and keep your own thoughts and become who you're supposed to be without being directed on what you're supposed to become.
Okay, so, well said. So back at that time, as a youth, you were a part of a group of other students, and you all met regularly outside of school.
Yes.
In the place where you are right now.
Yes.
To talk about ideas, can you tell us why was that important to you to do? What did you all talk about? You know, what were the goals of your group?
Well, lots of things happen that build up to that. To us really forming a group, because some of the original thoughts and conversation Shabazz wasn't involved in, but we formed a coalition from an argument that actually Shabazz and Mark Morton had gotten into at Linda McKinley School in the gym. And we all had our own beliefs, but there was three or four of us that were stronger beliefs. Our beliefs were more together. And Shabazz kind of sometimes would step out of the boundary lines, and he's very, very voiceful, very, but in saying that, he was still wanting to make sure he could become part of everything that we were doing to become structure. So there was different things that happened. Like I said, there was an argument. Johnny Wells got called a name by Mark Martin as Uncle Tom, led into an argument, and then we realized we were all in common about the same goals, I want to try and say, and trying to put something together. We just said, let's start meeting. So Johnny offered up his uncle's house. I'm being truthful. And I probably spent more time over here than any of them, because I still call him Uncle James. I mean, I had meals here. I ate chicken and fish. But I was, lots of times I didn't go home till after 11, 11:30 at night, knowing I was going to get in trouble with my dad. But we had strong beliefs. But the meeting started coming out about the things that we didn't like at school. Fairness, discipline. It seemed like you could do the same incident of the other race of people, but the trouble that you cause, you know, and we could even go and include it in the good trouble, John Lewis, but it always became a situation that we were the problem. And the discipline would be different. It would be suspension. Your parents had to come in, and it would be for the same incident. And they would hang out in the restrooms and do things in group, their groups, and we would do it in our groups. But when we got caught doing it, the discipline would always be different. And that led to hard feelings. It probably created disruption, because when you feel a certain way, you're gonna react a different way, back to the people that are in charge, back to the people that have the control, back to the people that are supposed to set the guidelines. And this is what we started not feeling good about. So we just started meeting, talking about different things, the school board, the school system, the leadership that we had at Linden. Some of us felt certain teachers were Uncle Toms, and you know, just you go through that as a student, as in growing up, not truly understanding some of the things that they have to go through and the positions that they have to have for us to go to another level. You don't always understand all that when you're a teenager, and even sometimes you don't when you're an adult. So our leadership and control was directed from that front office, but their control was directed from the school board. They have guidelines to follow. They have discipline rules they have to set forth, and it doesn't always appeal to the students like it did not to us. So we formed a group. We talked about a lot of different things in the basement. That's where our meetings were held. A lot of different people were on board. You already know about the three J's, Mark Morton, but we also had women involved. I call them women today because we were young adults coming into young adults back then. Valora Washington, Brenda Johnson, Zola Diggs. I mean, there was a lot of us, and a lot of people in and out. We had what I commend as what I called soldiers, which was, you know, strong people also. Donald Bassett, Al Young. I mean, we had a lot of people that would form different opinions and be there. So it was a collaborance of a community. It was a collaborance of courage and leadership from a lot of different people. The pastors of churches, Beth OAME right there on the corner of 26 and Cleveland Avenue, Pastor David Todd, I knew him personally. It's a Baptist church that was on the east side. It's on Sunbury Road now. Dr. Washington, the mighty great leadership of Nomo X, which I have been on a long time even before this. You know, he was a black Muslim. He was, you know, Farrakhan. So we had a lot of different sides to try and choose from to make ourselves fit in. Inward to figure some things out. And that, when I look back at it today, not that it was confusing, but we had to watch it about the people that wanted to influence us. You kind of have to take a step back, which we did, and say we don't know if that person might be trying to help us or hurt us. But the one thing we did listen to was ourselves. Because our leadership had to come from our thoughts and what we were thinking. And for someone to take that and then try and change you, the majority of time, you're gonna be more rebellious than you are gonna be listening to someone that doesn't understand where you're coming from. And we had a lot of that from great leaders. We don't understand where you kids are going with this, or we don't understand why y'all feel this way, but you weren't walking in our shoes. You weren't in these classrooms. You didn't see how these teachers talked to us. You didn't see the discipline that we went through. You didn't see how Mr. Reed, the principal, reacted to us. You didn't see the discipline change. You didn't see a lot of different changes because you're sitting outside of Linda McKinley. We're the ones going through the motion. So we formed a group, and there was a lot of people in and out. We had a lot of what I'm calling great soldiers. But if there's a community effort, even when you think you had five or six people doing their own thing, it wasn't about our thing. It was about changes for what we thought would help the situation.
Now, were you known as the Sergeant at Arms?
Oh, yeah.
why was that? Why were you the Sergeant at Arms?
We really didn't have officers. Valora Washington basically took notes at every meeting. I mean, you know, notebooks on, and in our conversation, but Whitaker, Shabazz, Johnny Wells, and Morton, they always would like the uproar and conversation, and a lot of times they would turn to the raising of the voice or out of control. So I was kind of the more level-headed person as far as not getting over aggressive. I'm gonna use that word. So they kind of looked at me and said, when we get out of control, Harrington, we're just gonna, like, you are the sergeant at arms. You bring it back to where it needs to be. Cause I mean, sometimes I'm sure the voices out of the basement probably would disrupt the family upstairs of his aunt and uncle, because we still had to respect their house, and that would be my first part of the conversation. Out of control, lack of respect. When you get lack of respect, in a minute, Armenians are gonna be out in front of the house on 23rd instead of down here in the basement, or either we gonna be going somewhere looking for space. None of us have any money to rent anything, so I think we better bring it back to order. It was, you know, I might a couple times, the Lord would probably say something, or, you know, but that was basically the title they gave me to help keep control. A lot of input from all of us, but we had three guys that sometimes would battle with conversation, and it sometimes leaded to uproars of out of control.
Gotcha. So I'm gonna go a little bit forward into 1971. Were you at the Black History Week performance in February, the play?
Yes.
And can you describe what happened and what you saw when the flyers went over the balcony and everything and what followed?
As we moved through the hallways into the auditorium, I chose to go up to the balcony. Linda McKinley has a main floor part of the auditorium, and we had a balcony that overhangs and you can look out over the stage. And I had preferred to do that. And we had several other people, my friends, we all chose to do that. And I was sitting on the outside row because he had doors, and then you walk down steps to get to the front of the overhang, which had a railing over it, all the way around. And on that side where I sat was where the largest part of the disruption came. And actually it came from a person that I sat next to in math class. His name is Rick Warren. We got along beautiful. I felt that we could have any kind of conversation and keep it in the right perspective during that time. Not knowing that he felt a certain way. And when you're unaware of that, when the disruption came, I was really surprised it was him. I was totally surprised, because I probably had more interaction with this person than any of the rest of our group. And he came down, he ran down the steps, he came in and he threw him out. I mean, heavy arm swing, and he just went out, came down like snowflakes. I was one of those that got up out of my seat and proceeded to try and catch him. But you know, sometimes lightning speed, when you got some brothers on your tail, lightning speed. I don't know, he was picking them up, putting them down. He wasn't no slow white boy that day. But anyhow, to say that, they had this, it was planned, because there was an automobile that he was approaching with fast speed. They opened the door, they basically started pulling out a little bit. He jumps in and they just kept it moving. And there was no trace of them out of sight within seconds. And
Did you see him after that incident?
No. No, I never saw Rick anymore after that incident. And I'm kind of thankful I didn't, because I think we probably would have clashed in a different way, because I probably would have been very nasty, uproar, ready to fight, because the words were very harsh, in words, talking about, you know, the community, talking about our people, our race, talking, you know, I can't remember, but, you know, the N-word was used throughout, you know, words of just derogatory, you know, for us and our race, you know, which they have a way of doing that, a low downgrade, which is supposed to make us feel bad about ourselves, but in retaliation, we should become smarter, because words don't hurt. Weapons and blows to your head hurt. And during that time, there was a lot that went on. There was very violent going on after people started reading it. There was a lot of violence of blacks against whites and them not able to defend themselves. There was girls being punched. There was boys being punched. There was hair being grabbed. It was a scene. And it was probably uncomfortable for a lot of people that felt the punishment. Personally, I can remember being shoved because when violence is erupt, people want to get out of the way. I can recall maybe being pushed up against the wall and maybe going down on the floor a couple times too. But I didn't... That's just from people trying to clear the school. They trying to get up out of there. Nobody was feeling comfortable at that time, black or white. They want to get up out of there. They want to get to outside surroundings so they can see what's going on. Because you know, a hallway, you're limited. Steps, you got to come down or either go up. So, I mean, there was people being pushed, trampled. There was a lot. There was a lot.
So let's move a little bit further into the year to March. I mean, to May, sorry. Did you, were you part of the march to Franklin Park on May 19th?
Yes. One of the front row people where there, we had, I mean, basically I felt like everybody black at Lyndon McKinley went to the march. That's what it looked like. And you know, from Lyndon to Franklin Park, it's a pretty good hump. You know, it's not a 1 mile mark, it's miles in between. There was no disruption. There was no violence. We laughed, we had conversation. I can even recall some people starting up songs. I can even remember people shouting, "We shall overcome." I can remember seeing people coming out of their houses waving at us. I can remember seeing some people join in on the march to help unite our efforts in what we were doing. I can remember a lot of encouragement from our community, from Duxbury all the way down through Franklin Park past churches. I mean, the black community was aware that this was going to happen because children interact. We didn't have cell phones back then, but we got plenty of conversation and that telephone that hanged on the wall. So you were always in touch with your friends all over. You know, I went to a junior high on the east side. I went to elementary at 11th Avenue. I went to Lyndon McKinley. So I had a ring of associations. And I attended Trinity Baptist Church. I can't leave Reverend E.A. Pam out because he was also behind some of these things that we were doing where I attended. But in saying that, the march was the most powerful thing that a community can see, witness, be part of, participate in. It probably showed a lot of children younger than us, junior high kids joined in. Kids didn't go to school that day just to walk with us. I'm sure there were probably parents that called off sick that day just to walk with us, because you don't really know the involvement that was there. I just know it was a massive amount of people on Cleveland Avenue all the way down till we got to the park. Police cars following us to make sure there's no disruption, to keep us in line. You know, a lot of different things went on, but we had young black teenagers growing up in Lyndon McKinley that we had stationed, that I called soldiers. Everybody participated with cheerful meaning. There was nothing derogatory, there was no nastiness. We just kept it pleasant all the way. Going and returned back without a problem. 16, 17, 18 year old kids, that's an accomplishment.
Why were you marching to Franklin Park on that day?
Well, our stronger belief during that day, because of Malcolm X's birthday, we decided to have a march to the park. It was well in advance. You know, a lot of our stuff was thought out. It wasn't just a reaction. There were plans, you know, to different things. Assemblies, the march, the involvement, church meetings. I mean, all that came out of this circle. You know, and it was a tight range of a circle. When you think about where Lyndon McKinley is, the black churches were from the east side of Columbus to 26 and Cleveland Avenue, Bethel AME. So the march was really important for symbolizing that we want change. It was a symbol of change. It was a symbol of this is the way to go because, I mean, but two of our strongest leaders, they all had marches. Martin Luther King, people don't think Malcolm marched. He did. He marched with a soldier of men. And if you ever watch the movie, you will see a captain, a police officer say, that man has too much power. And both groups, both of our groups of courage and strong leadership, if you notice back during that time, we did not slum with dress code. Sharp suits, ties, hats, cashmere coats, I mean all of it. There was not a downgrade look. It was always a look of being distinguished and high grade. And it meant something as a child growing up that this is the look that we're supposed to present ourselves in being. And that look should help. We thought it would help bring us equality, maybe different parts, because this was their dress code too. So we showing you, you ain't the only one that can dress like this. But on that day to the march, we were in our t-shirts, red, black, and green. Our flag was flying. I even carried it part of the way. We kind of switched off, you know, and everybody participated. But it was a good day for the community all the way.
So then some days after that, you mentioned the role of churches. And so there was a community meeting at Bethel AME Church on the 24th of May. Were you at that meeting?
I was at the meeting, but I didn't. So, I was fortunate to kind of start my career with a job which I ended up calling just over broke. because that's their way of also keeping us suppressed and down, you know, to limit our funds. So if you can't think outside the box and end up with a business, which I did, and do different things, you locked into their system. So I went to the meeting at the church, but I also had a job, which I had to get to after that. So I was not there for the portion of the walk from the church to Lyndon McKinley, where they eventually hung the our National's black flag. I received a phone call that evening after I got home. It was late, from Mr. Johnny Wells Shabazz, my good friend, and told me what him and Bassett were together, and it was raised, and I shouted for glory. You know, I said, I'm sorry I missed that part of it, but I did attend the meeting. At that time, I was not a member of the Bethel AME Church, but I did know Pastor David Todd. Actually, that was where I was married. I was married in that church.
Can you talk about the meeting a little bit?
The meeting we had, there was high school kids there. There was parents with their children there. There were parents. There were strong leaders there. It just wasn't him in leadership as a pastor. There were different people. There was people, I believe, from the city. I think there was somebody there that represented the coalition part of that Dr. Charles Ross had underway. I can't really remember if he was there, but I know there was representation there. Because he was involved in a lot of different things, in politics, social studies, and all that. That was his journey. That was his strong points to keep people involved, including us. Nothing negative I ever saw come out of our conversation with him. But the meeting was there to focus on the majority of the things that we felt was best for the community and why we were a group of students that were so voiceful in trying to form a coalition and move things the way that we saw them fit. But it's like we always said, you gotta step out to be recognized. The squeaky wheel always needs the oil, but if it's rolling fine, nobody's gonna pay attention. So we had a lot of tension during that time, a lot.
There was something that you said when we talked, and I wonder if you could just speak to this a little bit. You mentioned equality, education, and fair treatment.
So yes.
Can you talk a little bit about what I mean, I know that you also said that the parents were very upset, and you all as youth were upset. What were the things that you were upset about, and what did you want? You know, how did you want change to happen?
Well, we wanted to see change happen for the better of us. We wanted to see more blackness awareness. We wanted to see a longer period of time for black history, even though we had black history teachers. We just wanted to see more outspokenness for us. I mean, it's almost like, you know, we're a black school now, but a lot of the things that we were given didn't pertain, you know, sometimes to you, or you didn't think it did. So it was mostly like awareness. We had parents there that were on our side. We had parents on that were there at meetings that weren't on our side. Some black leaders were, some weren't. But we had to find a neutral spot. But it always came out with, we thought we had the final say because we were the ones that were outspoken.
And so that next day, you came to school, and when you got to school, first of all, was that red, black, and green flag still up?
No.
It was not.
No.
Okay, and then there was also an assembly on the 25th, that next day, an unauthorized assembly.
Wow.
And can you talk about that and what the police raid that happened?
That was the day of the, I call it the massive blow up of Columbus Police Department terrorizing a Columbus public school full of youth. I came into the assembly probably not right at the beginning. I can recall coming in one of the doors, and as I came in, I noticed Dr. Charles Ross was off to my left, very close up against the back wall, which I always would recognize. He said hi to me because he was aware of who I was by name. And at that time, Shabazz was, I can recall him speaking. I can recall a lot of, I call them members of the team, also being down front. And a lot of our soldiers and females were all kind of just spread it out through the assembly. I can recall an incident with Brenda Smoot, who was a very tough young lady, throwing a blow. I can recall us exiting the auditorium. I can recall the police marching in on us. I can recall Dr. Charles Ross being grabbed by police officers and treated very roughly. I can recall a lot of teachers in our way. I can recall Mr. Reed and the vice principals, Mr. Steele, and everybody running around. I can recall a lot of things that were in total chaos, out of control, turmoil. Policemen marched down that sidewalk into that school with clubs. Some of them probably had them little hard hats on that they probably don't use much anymore because they done, you know, did a lot of different things. So I can recall a lot of different things, but it went from peaceful to disruption. And it was a disruption not in a good way. I saw Mr. Green get dragged out of the school and across the yard of the school. I don't like the term janitor. He was a highly skilled custodian. I saw teachers get pushed, knocked down. I'm probably sure some of them got sucker punched too. I saw white kids. I saw a lot of violence. I mean, it was another disruption. And when that happens, kids may respond very negative towards one another. And it was just a very uncomfortable day. And I'm sure a lot of us were in fear of being arrested. I mean, it was a lot going on. Kids running into each other. It was a fearful day because these officers were swinging clubs, and it wasn't two or three of them. It was a parade of them coming in on us. It was It almost, to us, it probably felt and looked like it was the whole force. You know, the one thing when I think back now, I don't know if I ever noticed, but I'm not sure any of them were my skin color, because that wasn't the concentration that we were on. And I know we had black officers, but if they were there, they had a job to do also as far as trying to restore order. But I don't recall, everybody I seen did not look like me.
Can you try to describe how you felt though when you were seeing those things? I mean, when you just, you said something about a line of cops coming up the sidewalk into the school, and just that image alone, to me, I mean, that kind of shook me.
That,
and I'm wondering
that,
when this all was happening, how did you feel?
That image alone, it was a scary moment, because we all know what they came for. We all knew what the process was when you seen them, and we all knew it was gonna be a disruption. And when that happens, you know, this thing right here, it's gonna speed up. Your adrenaline is gonna increase. Your mind is gonna be all over the place. And all you worried about is maybe that you don't get hurt, that the disruption doesn't affect you. And I'm sure every individual probably felt that way, that they did not wanna be hit and harmed and hurt. So, I was unclear about maybe the fear that I carried during that time, but the adrenaline was too much of a rush for me to worry about fear. I had to worry about what was going on, because I was seeing people that I knew that were adults that were also involved, and they were there standing up for us. They were there standing up and protecting us. I mean, we had teachers that were standing there protecting us. I mean, white teachers also, you know, pulling cops away and things like that, because everybody now with that fair skin ain't gonna always be feeling what's going on either now. So, you just saw a lot of disruption, and it happened so quick, you really sometimes, you didn't really have a lot of time to think. You were just trying to protect yourself. So.
And do you remember how the day ended?
Whew. The day ended with a lot of, the day ended with the school closing. Nobody was in the hallways, nobody was in the auditorium, nobody was in classroom. Everybody went home. Now, as far as people gathering, everybody's gonna have their little clique, and everybody did that outside of Linda McKinley and probably away from the school, because we did. But that day ended with some of us uniting and could not believe exactly what occurred, because it was in total shock. It wasn't like we knew this was coming. None of us did. None of us knew that this was coming. So you're unprepared. So the adrenaline, the heart pumping, the blood moving fast, it was a time to try and escape, calm yourself down, regroup. You're looking for certain people. You don't know where they are. You're confused, so you just keep backing away from the school before you get picked up and you become, retaliated against, you know, as a student or whatever. I'm sure some of them probably went home, you know, or went to friends' house, but the day ended, today ending in a moment of confusion, and that left you at that state. You're wondering who got hurt, who else got arrested, who didn't make it home, who got brutally hit with a club. I mean, you're wondering about all that. And, you know, then you try and regroup yourself, and it's just a lot of conversation about this happening, about that going on, and everybody's conversation is, it's just a mess. It's just, you know, everybody was kind of fearful. And even to the point that, you know, you get hit the wrong way with that club, you fear for your life. And we as children, we saw that constantly during our black marches, when it was just us in Montgomery, Alabama, across the bridge, and the March on Washington, and the 100, we ain't gonna forget the 100 million man march either, you know. But those times don't seem to be existing anymore for our race of people. We kind of stand back now and look at everything from a distance, and our courage of leadership back then, I feel, was totally much stronger then than it is today. That's just my own opinion from what I see. It's like the leaders that we do have, the including the kids, until these marches came along, I wasn't sure what the youth wanted. But it took a death of a black man to bring that out of them. It been going on for years. It took a lot of it took a lot. The death of George Floyd on camera, in front of public view, in front of the eyes of our people and the nation and the world, this thing blew up bigger than that man that had his knee on his neck ever could imagine. And the outcome of it is not just that city waiting to see, it's the world. And the world has to change. It's not just the police officers. It's not just, I'm gonna be truthful, it ain't just white folks. It's us too. Because we have to take more of an initiative to get out there like Martin Luther King and Martin did and make those sacrifices. We have to be able to get out there and instead of being cool, we have to get out there and figure out the strategy for advancement. Because we got too much gun violence today, black on black crime. We got it all and it's out of control to where I'm not sure if we can regroup all this right now. Even with the marches and the protests, there's still a limited amount that they want to do. But I've never seen a group of white people march with us like this ever before in the history of marching. And that takes it to another level now because they're marching with us. Their kids are being abused. Their kids are being hit with the rubber bullets. Their kids are being the ones sprayed with mace. It's a totally different environment now to control this thing. And our president, I'm not even gonna make too many comments about him. It is what it is. As he said, it is what it is. Well, he is what he is. And until we get him out of office, voting, it does help. But voting is also a form of trickery also. Until we get people in there with enough backbone and spine to really want to make a change and stand up against the system, because a lot of people don't know that economics is the movement. White supremacists and economics is the movement. And until we realize that and take some of this buku money we get as athletes, and take some of this buku money we get as singers and put it back into the system for us, who knows where it's going to end up. But when I look about a lot of different things that go on with our icons, I don't necessarily agree with all that, but that's another conversation. But there's a lot of things that go on in a systematic system that don't involve us. We get a small piece of the pie. It can be an 8-piece pie. We may not even receive a 16th of it, you know, to feed ourselves with. I mean, look at a lot of different things we go with, and that involvement also reflects back on our school system, because they are limited on what they want to do, also by geographics. Everything's listed to our zip code. They know about you by your zip code. Whether you got money, whether you trying to receive money, whether you on food stamps, and now they want to put a chip in us so they can control us even further. I mean, there's a lot goes on. So in saying all that, we just have to be careful, but we can't give up the struggle, because that's what it is. We can't give up our strong leaders to keep being assassinated. We have to find a way of protection. We have a way that we need to be able to figure out how to buy land, how to feed ourselves, how to clothe ourselves, how to provide homes and shelter. There's a lot we have to do as a race of people and quit depending on the systematic that it is for us.
Can I throw in just a quick question? Cecilia? Can I jump in real quick? Just a really quick question to before we move on, because we covered a lot of ground. I wanted to ask you, you mentioned the police marching in, and I'm curious, did they come in and organize? Did they march in like soldiers might march in?
Yes.
Or did they spill out and come in as
No, they came through one systematic way. They marched down that sidewalk together, dress right, dress elbows. I'm sure there was communication on how they filter in. Once they entered the school, that's when the separation formed throughout the hallway into the auditorium and the hallway systems. I'm not sure if some went up. I'm sure they did. because they had this design. When there's violence erupting, or what they feel is erupting, everything's a systematic design. They knew why they were coming. They already had their orders. They knew who was stationed where, and they knew what to look for, who to look for, and
cool. That two more quick follow-ups. That was really fun.
Alan.
Yeah.
I just want to piggyback on that though. What do you have any thoughts as to how they knew to come? Because for them to come in that way, I mean, that obviously involves organization, and there was a plan beforehand. So, do you have any thoughts as to what brought them there?
You know, to get back to the question about it being planned, I think to a degree it was planned. We don't know who made a phone call. We don't know how uncomfortable the administrative office was. We don't know if they asked them to come out for control, but there's a system in there that if they felt threatened, which I'm sure they did, they probably feel threatened for themselves, for the students, for the different colors of races.
One second, thank you, sir. Hey, bro.
Johnny's best friend.
Oh. What is your name?
Johnny Hanson.
Johnny Hanson.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's great.
You should let me almost live in your house.
Yeah. You talk fondly about those meals.
Yeah, man. They'll fed me and everything.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good memory.
I think the system has a way to put things in place when there's in what had been going on, and it's no telling if the school board asked them to show up, that the contact came through the principal, Mr. Reed, but it came from somewhere, because the cruisers were there, the wagons were there to haul away, everything was in place. Like they knew something would jump off, but nothing really jumped off until they got there and came in. Mm-hmm. It was peaceful. Everything was peaceful until they came in. And one of the things that really ignited it was the small fight and the grabbing of adults that were trying to help protect us. But I think what really helped ignite us was when they grabbed Charles Ross. I witnessed it. I witnessed the officers coming in. He was back up against that wall and going the other side of the door, and you know, they asked him where he was, why he was there. He's a citizen, he had a right to be in the school, and they just went there and started to, you know, four or five cops abusing him. You know, to handcuff him and put their hands on him and hit him a few times, you know. It was that. Now that did something to me mentally, because I witnessed it. A lot of students did, because I was on the back end of that assembly during that time. Like I said, I came through the doors and just spoke to him, and that was something I just didn't understand.
Can you talk about Mr. Charles Ross and his influence on you, or what he meant to you?
I probably feel a different way, because the interaction we had was all positive. It was positive. It never did he try, and I don't truly believe he tried to sway us in one negative way or anything, because the conversation was, when I was around him, was always about what input we were trying to bring to a situation. Some others may have had a different relationship with him. I used to also see him. I can even recall knowing he was married and had two children. One carried his first name, and the other one, he had a brother named Marcus. I mean, I can recall all of that. I recall positiveness. He was over part of our OSU department. I knew that. Anytime I would see him out or whatever, if he saw me and recognized me, it was always good feeling. He asked me how my parents were. He asked me about whatever, you know. Even after I would see him, even when there was no longer contact, when you visibly have a connection to somebody, regardless of how they age, and you're still gonna remember that face. And he might look up, be pumping gas, and I'd look up and say, "How you doing, Mr. Ross?" And he'd look up and go, How you doing? And I say, I'm doing good or whatever, but everything was positive. But he had, to me, he had a lot of courage. He was a very strong leader. And any interactions that somebody had that was not good feelings, it's not the way I feel personally about the man. I looked at, he was someone I could look up to. He was someone over the black part of OSU that I strongly looked for influence and conversation with. And not going on to college, but ending up working like I had went to college on my job, he would always say, you always told me he's going to school. When you gonna go back? I never did. But I have nothing but great vibes for someone who I think was a very important and a famous person to me because of his leadership role. Now others may have some kind of other relationship with him, but nothing but good vibes from me. I never saw anything but quality love, and that's what I always gave back.
And you talk a little bit about some of the other adults, Gary Davis, Bruce Bunch,
Tom Brown,
and how their presence at the school affected you.
Well, those were our two black history teachers. And actually, I still hold a friendship with both of them today. I still have conversations with them. I've been over Gary's house several times. I interact with Bruce Bunch. That was my black history teacher. But even today, I saw Gary. I talked to Bruce Bunch now that I'm a Facebook member. Social media every once in a while, sending different things. I don't get into it like most people will, but there's a different reaction. But their leadership and their involvement in teaching school, I felt it was excellent for what we needed at that time, because our history books lack what we have done. When we have come from our country, our earth over there, of green grass, of kings and queens, with powerful nations and everything, and the way that they brought us over, they just stripped us of our, tried to strip us of our pride, our manhood, our women. They have raped, you know, and impregnated and done all of that. And for them to help guide us through all this and help us understand it, when you really get into the black history and understanding who some of our great leaders were to help this revolution in bringing us to where we are today, they taught it. They had to bring us to a level that we needed to be mentally involved. That's how you strengthen. That's how you become stronger, knowing who you are and where you come from. So they didn't have any involvement in the violence. They had the involvement in making sure we understood black history, participating and doing things in a fashionable way without being disrupted. They would talk to us, not making any decisions for us, but they would talk to us about some of the changes and how we might see them going and what we were trying to become and where we were going with this. But like I said, I am still in friends with both of them today. It's nothing for me just to jump in my car and ride over to Gary Davis's house, even though he wasn't my teacher. We became very strong friends, and also Bruce Bunch, which I still stay in contact with both of them. They like big brothers to me. They like men I look up to for encouragement. They like men of courage. They great leadership roles. They taught us a lot of the things that kids never hear about today. They got you involved in what you needed to try and become, you know, in becoming a man and becoming somebody that, you know, would be very fond of their wives and their families. And I mean, you got some of, you pull some of all this from them. I'm just thankful I had that involvement with them, because they don't get that today. You know, that little bit of black history they get today, it's a total different structure, because they limited on what they could give us. You know, when that classroom door closed, there wasn't nothing that they couldn't bring up for us, you know, and in making sure we understood who we were, where we came from, what we should try and be about, how to keep yourself positive and uplifted, and have pride in what you do and what you stand for, in being who you are and where you want to go with your life. I received some of all that, and I commend them and thank them today. which I know I still highly respect both of them. And when I see them, I even still get excited, you know. And they are a lot older than we are now, but they're still here. They're still giving back. And if I needed either one of them, I know I could call them and receive.
So, and I definitely know from talking to them that the feeling is mutual, for sure. They both spoke very highly of you.
Yeah, they're my older brothers, both of them.
That's really beautiful, man.
So in 7-1, you were a senior. Can you talk a little bit about your graduation?
After this
trauma that you experienced. First of all, were you traumatized? Let me ask you that.
Yes. I mean, I can't sit here and say I wasn't. I mean, I'm a teenager. I'm becoming into manhood. Yes, you're traumatized. You've seen your friends abused. You've seen people you looked up to abused. You've seen a lot going on. You've seen abuse given in both ways to other students from students. You definitely have to be traumatized, and you have to also be thankful that it involved you and to the point that you ended up dead, hurt, shoved down steps or whatever. I believe it traumatized all of us, and I don't think it's something that we will ever forget, but I do think we're thankful for maybe even going through it, because it helps set us to a point where we probably look at life a lot different than students do today, because it seems like we have maybe a real rough time of it there in 1971, and including even them shutting the school down before our graduation. And therefore, appearing in 1971, we were the last class that graduated from our high school, from all high schools, because they moved. I don't know if it was due to the violence, but they moved graduations from the high schools to Mershon Auditorium on OSU. For a period of time, I think they just went back several years ago to start letting them graduate from the high schools again. But we had instructions on things we couldn't do. At our graduation and marching down out of the school into the stadium. The platform was set up. There was a certain look that we had to have. There was a certain type of clothes they wanted us to wear. And you know, you can't tell no kids not to wear no sunglasses, because we just gonna do the opposite. Everybody went across that stage, got on glasses. And it was like, due to the factor that the majority of us probably had some sort of feeling of attitude towards the school, towards the system, from going through all this. I don't understand how you could not feel a certain way and be happy about your graduation, because look how it ended up. It was a turmoil, it was violent, it was people being arrested, it was great leadership, it was unhappiness, you were fearful. I mean, who's gonna be happy? You were thankful you got your diploma, and you probably walked across that stage and said, thank God I'm still alive, you know. And we had our parents there, which was very positive, and that was probably the biggest uplifting for them, is that even through all this, that their children survived this, and they still achieved why they sent us to school to graduate.
Talk about how the events that happened and everything that went down, everything you saw and you felt, how did that affect you going forward in life, your path forward?
Well, going forward in life, it taught me that there were certain things, because I continually talk about this. I think I also shared that with you in a conversation with my children, with my parents. With my grandparents, because I wasn't married, I didn't have children at that time. With people on my job that knew I was a graduate of Lyndon McKinley, there were certain things that came up, like, why did that happen? Why did this happen? And, you know, it got to the point where certain people, I just wouldn't talk about it anymore, because it would always take you back mentally somewhere that you probably didn't need to be at that time. Yeah, I think it changed me to become more aware of what I didn't want to be around, not to be able to accept a lot of the things that they tried to put on us as an individual and also as a race of people. Mm-hmm. And I always wanted to know where my closest friends were in their that lifetime too. So we stayed in pretty much close communication. But I think it gave me a greater awareness of what the system really does when they want to oppress you. What the system does when they really don't want to give you equality, rights, and all different levels. What the system does when they want to keep us on welfare, when they don't want to see us advance with government structure, when they don't want to see us advance on the job. Everything's a limitation. And even if you go above those limits, you're still limited on what they want to give out in economics. And until we figure out how to get around that, because I'm not even sure at my age of 67 right now that becoming part of it is going to solve any of it, because it's been going on for 400 years. And it's like, if this is still going on for 400 years and you can't, the changes that are coming aren't quick enough for you, you know. And we listen to different types of music, and the last poets, and the revolution will not be televised, and John Coltrane, and me and Johnny call each other up sometimes, and we talk about the old times, and we'll remind each other to get on YouTube or whatever and listen to this and that. But you know, the revolution will not be televised if one comes about. But right now, the structure is so, it's not focused for us right now. The way I'm feeling is it's still very unfocused, because what direction are we moving in right now? What direction, who's leading us? What direction, who's answering us? What direction is right for us right now? What direction? It's a gut feeling when you believe in what you believe in. And it comes up to the brain. That's what makes us act out. And what is what I keep saying, even to my grandkids and my great-grandkids, because I got some of them too that just started school or whatever. You know, I talk to them on different levels because I want them to be aware. We have to keep our families, our friends aware of what we're doing, where we need to try and go, where we're trying to become. And I'm not sure, as I said, if this system is going to work for us, because it's always against us. And now I read a lot too, like John Shabazz does, but now I'm reading about things that are going on in the U.S. because I want to stay up on top of what's going on, the riots and the gun control and all that. And you know, I'm reading things where, you know, we buying up some land down in the South to do some different things. Families, 70, 80, 90, 100 acres and more. Some of them, they don't even turn into gun ranges, some brothers. A lot of them, they're becoming and trying to create farms. You know, that's another thing we need to look at doing on, because we spend more money on nonsense than we do good sense than any other race in the world, but we don't buy from black. That's another subject. But until we can turn our economics around, we're going to always be oppressed. And that's my true belief. And the only way to get from abundance is to smile, to look happy, and go around the corner and do your thing.
All right. Well, that actually, you answered my next question, because I was going to ask you what you saw as the way forward. And it sounds like economics.
Economics. Without that, you don't have anything. You know, yeah. I mean, just think about it. Who? I'm not being derogatory, but we just gonna talk about Nike. We ain't getting rich off of Nike. We making Nike rich. We ain't getting rich on MJ. We making him rich. But take part of that. He gives back. But take part of that and do it in a different method. Buy up some land somewhere and let us figure out how to develop it. Invest more in our black banks, what few we have, and our credit unions. You got 3, 4, 5, 6 of them somewhere around here in Ohio. I know one or two of them up in Cleveland. But how many of us really go to them to borrow money to pay to buy our houses or whatever, to give them the opportunity for that interest and growth? We have to change our pattern of thinking for progress. And until we do that, wow. I don't know how much longer this is going to take, but we had a standstill until we turn the economics around. It's just, that's the way, that's the movement of life.
I will say that I do think, I think that awareness is growing. The process is happening. I mean, I think we all wish it would have happened a long time ago, but I do think that awareness is happening. There are different things, and I can talk to you about it later, but you know, there are things that are happening where we see Black communities responding with dollars, you know, supporting Black businesses. So I don't want to go off on that.
Right. I know that's you just asked me, you know, the question about how I felt, and I still feel positive, but I kind of like to see it kind of pick up pace. I'm going to put it like that, and it needs to pick up pace. We don't want to keep spinning the bicycle wheel and ain't moving.
Well,
I want to see the wheel move. And I was hoping I saw it move a lot quicker before my time ended. And I don't know if it's even going to be there for my grandchildren at this point, or your children, or anybody's children. I don't know, because they have a way of being resistance and pushing back. And when you're trying to move an ideal forward, there's going to be resistance. And there's going to be pushing back. There's just no other way. Life is that way. And it's just not only for Blacks, but it's the superior race that wants to push back against everybody else. Because we even got somebody in the White House right now wants to stop immigration, wants to stop people coming over here. How the hell does he think he got over here? The people that were from this country, they somewhere way out on the reservation, without running water, without proper food, without proper medications, and they haven't given back to them. They don't plan on it. So where does that leave the rest of us? And we all in a fight together. And it's for progress, it's for fairness, and it's for equality. But I just don't know where it's going to end up until that wheel starts rolling quicker.
Well, I think you being a part of this, though, is part of that. You know,
yes.
I think it will be very powerful for, you know, young people, especially people of all ages, but especially the youth, to see and hear about what you experienced and what you did, what you all did as youth. That's important for them to understand that this is not a new struggle.
No.
I mean, you know what I mean? That this is not, this didn't start with George Floyd or Breonna Taylor or Sandra Bland.
Right, or
this has been going on for a long, long time.
400 years.
So on that note, I'm gonna ask you as well, if you could talk to young activists now, what would you say to them? What advice would you give to them today in 2020?
The first thing is, don't let anybody change your thoughts. Because if they can change your thoughts, they will change your input. If you give in to that, you're not going to be able to progress the way you feel is necessary. And we can't sit here and say one progress is better than another. It's going to take a united effort. It's going to take city after city. It's going to take time. And town after town, it's gonna take time, and it's gonna take all races. And now that we do have other countries on board with us, I think that's a very positive thing. But the thing is you gotta vote. We gotta try and get some power in there that's gonna move things forward to us without being a pacifier, just something to suck on like we've been getting for all these years. And it's not just for the Black races, for all races. Because equality is supposed to be there across the board. But it's going to take strong minds not willing to give in to the systematic system and say, okay, you got to keep moving it forward, but you got to be positive about it. And I'm not gonna say violence ain't the way, because they retaliate to violence with us, but if it comes down to that, be prepared to handle it. Keep yourself prepared. And that's an old Boy Scout slogan, be prepared. You look at some of the things that just happened during this protest. Bringing in secret agents to fight against us, bringing in tear gas against us. You know, we American citizens. And you treat us like we were back in the Revolutionary War. And then we fight about statues and flags, and this is supposed to be one country, and you letting this go on? You need to abolish all that the same way they did slavery. Abolish all that and bring it to true light. It needs to come to true light. Now, if you ain't gonna give me nothing, tell me. So I'm going over here and do my own thing. But if you wanna try and figure something out and make it work together, then be about that. Don't be BSing us and playing games and giving us, like I said, that old candy side pacifier. Keep it real, because underneath the dust, it comes to light. And when that light comes about, who knows what's gonna happen. It could be positive or it could be negative. And I don't really think the United States wants negativeness right now. And I think that's why they're pushing the Biden and the Harris ticket so strongly. When I listened to my only black president last night, it was body slam time. I got him, did a cheerleader buck off a chair. You know what I'm saying? I spread them out. Cause in my time of seeing presidents, I have never seen a president slam another president in that form. But he has been slamming Obama since he got in office. He smiled in his face and has been stabbing him in the back. And when you stab him in the back, you stabbing us. Because he was for the American people. And he made a lot of good accomplishments. You know, and they just have to stay as focused as possible. They got to get the leadership, and they got to get some economics behind this movement. Because if you don't have strong leadership and economics, you just blowing dust.
Beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you. That was fantastic. I can't even tell you. Alan, did you have any other questions for Mr. Harrington?
This has been it's been an honor to talk with you and get to know you, brother. I really love what you said. I think it was fantastic. So there are lots of things I'd love to talk to you about, but I got a feeling you and I are going to talk again.
Yes.
For sure.
Yes.
Because there's a lot of things we want to talk about.
Yes.
So I'll follow up, but I do want to ask this. So I want to talk with you more. I want to find out if this, I'm not asking this now, but what I want to find out is if there's anything that you read along the way that inspired you to activism. Can you talk about that just briefly? Was there anything you read with, and I know that John talked about certain things, but there might be other things that you read along the way that might have impacted you? And then there's one more question I want to ask you.
What inspired me?
Was there anything that you read or listened to along the way that, when you think back about it, really was connected with your activism? Like, this led you, this affected you, this motivated you.
I think the greatest inspiring part is seeing the courage of our strongest leaders and the backbone of my grandfather and what challenges he had, because he was the very strong entity into my life. If he moved, I moved with him. And he raised me to be a godly man. There's certain things in the Bible that have been written since it's been written that are even affecting us today. Because this virus, even the one 100 years ago, it was already written before it got here. I'm not gonna start quoting scriptures, but if you know anything about reading, just read it till you find it. That'll bring you up to date. This wasn't about, it was more about politics this for me and what happens, because that's what is going on with the system. Politics is controlling it. So understanding where you at and knowing how to help change it, I think that's the greatest inspiring thing for me, is we as children and teenagers feeling, because you know most of the parents called us kids.
Yes.
You know, but we were becoming young adults. And for us to have that mentality of thinking that during that time. I think that should be enough encouragement for anybody that hears about this story and says, if they could do it during that time, and they saw all these other things going on that inspired them, hopefully there will be some inspirement for others out of this, what is going on right now, from what we're talking about to the marchings, to white folks participating, to trying to change a systematic system that I still don't know how quickly it can be changed. As we all know, economics, you know, a lot of our decisions about this country are only based off the richest people in the world. Let's keep it for real. And if you know anything about the richest people in the world, all you gotta do is read about them and see how they control different things. There's books and things that I have read on this level, but that inspires me to go out and want to teach, and especially the youth. If you look at part of the system that we once were during slavery, we built this United States. 400 years of slavery, built all them houses. We developed the streets coming into the White House. We did it all. And now, I don't know what changed, but as far as skills, we lack them. We lack them today, you know? And this is another conversation about things that are going on, you know, with infrastructure and all that. But I look in my neighborhood, right here in Linden, and now they're rehabbing all these homes and stuff, but the people in here that's doing it, they don't look like me. So I think we need to be able to find different ways to inspire our own people to bring that level back up to a different degree than what I'm seeing right now. But it was my grandparents and parents in the community itself. It was my friends growing up. It was our courage and leadership. But the person that probably stiffened up my backbone, with, I'm got to say, it was my grandfather, man. It was John Daniel Burnley. He came from Atlanta, Georgia, Warren, Georgia, which is right outside of Atlanta. You know, I even visited Stone Mountain, which, you know, is down in Georgia. I wanted to see where they was lynching us and doing a lot of things. I just always kept myself in the area of where we were mistreated, because, you know, we went from the South to the North. And, you know, I like to read stories, and I like to see movies made about some of that, even though they don't portray us in the right form. But it still gives our children a chance to see, because they're really lacking the history.
Is there any particular incident that when you scan your mind, when you look around, you see a particular interaction that you could talk to us about a little bit in detail, almost blow by blow?
That was the incident with Dr. Charles Ross. I witnessed it. I was feet away from him.
Can you talk about it a little more?
I mean, to see them come up on him, because they knew who he was. I mean, you know, he's been going through a lot of different changes just right there in the structure of OSU, thinking that he was influencing high school students, because they even wrote articles about it in the Dispatch. And I know he had his own organization that was, you know, a little older than us. I can't recall what it was, but I'm familiar with a lot of the things he did, because I also researched it when he got mistreated. I also watched the taking down of him there, you know, to the ground where he was fighting. I'm talking about blows, man. I'm talking about defending himself, you know. I'm talking about feet kicking and arms going and punches being thrown. But it's hard to overtake four or five, six men, and the more he resisted, the more surrounded him. That was probably the strongest incident I ever seen happen to someone that I totally looked up for, and I thought that they should have had a lot more respect for him. But they felt he was out of place, and he had, like I said, he had a right to be there. They don't even know if he was invited there to help keep us under control, to maybe inspire us to feel a little more comfortable about what was about to happen. But like I said, they came in with a plan. And when you saw them march in four or five wide, and they sprung open both of them doors, and they came straight in, and you might have come in maybe 10, 15, maybe 20 feet, and then there's the hallway or less, and the hallway goes to the door they came in, went to the left. You walk down a few more feet, the steps went up. I saw some of them going up. I never went to the second floor. But I saw the reaction of what happened on the first floor, from the auditorium to the hallway to the outside. And it was very unpleasant to witness all of that. Not only just for him, but like I said, for Mr. Green, I saw the hauling away of him across the yard. We all, you know, looking like, wow, what's going on? Like I said, we saw teachers involved in pulling cops off of kids. Well, they was on all of us. It was, they were more on black than anything else because everybody else looked like them. But there's one thing I said, I really can't recall seeing a black officer. I'm not saying there wasn't any there, but he was still instructed, if he was, to take us down just like the rest of them. He has a job and a position to uphold. Yes, and his being sworn in as an officer, so.
Were there any white teachers who helped pulling cops off of black students?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. They were involved in also some trying to protect us. They were. And it wasn't, like I said, it's not all just one-sided, like, okay, you guys is in here, let's go get them. No, it was about also trying to protect us, because I don't think a lot of them were aware of what was getting ready to go down either until it went down. I had a lot of, you know, it was standard back then that your coaches were black and or your black history teachers were black, and you might have had a vice principal that was black, but the authority came from the main person, which doesn't look like me. So there was a difference, a matter of respect and how to feel a different way. It was just all right there. It was a collaborative feeling, but to see that go down the way it did, to answer your question, it was devastating for me. I'm 17 years old. I ain't never seen nobody billy club to death, hit all up and down the leg, and in the arm, maybe probably caught a clip of the head. Because I remember even that day, I believe it was Whitaker that told me he had like a little mark on the side of him where he almost got hit or whatever, but he kind of snatched back, so it kind of glazed him. But it's just a thought that will never leave you once you witness it, because you don't understand why it's even going on. You just know it's happening. And that's with any type of violence. When you're caught off guard, which that's what I feel we were, it was an attack. It was an attack on children. And it still goes on today. It was just a bad thing. But there was turmoil, not only at Linden, it was just throughout the different communities. Like I said, East High School, Central High School. I know there was written things about Eastmore, but the real knockdown violence happened right there on Duxbury.
That was powerful. That was very powerful. My last question, I've been reflecting on this as we talk, and I listened to you, such a thoughtful man, reflecting on this over a long period of time. I want to ask you, thinking about one of our shared heroes, John Lewis. Was it good trouble? Was it necessary?
Yes. And that's why I made the statement.
I want to hear you say it. I want to hear myself.
That's why I made the statement. It was good trouble, because nobody perfected better than him. He perfected beyond a level that I'm not sure anybody else black can perfect it to, because he started the term. And he went from the bus rides to his death fighting for equal rights for his people. I don't know if anybody could do it that long. He was basically just started in college, so he was still a teenager when he hooked up with Martin Luther King. How old was he when he left here?
Well, I don't remember his age.
That's how many years he'd been fighting the battle. And then when he got elected, he even fought the battle harder, mm-hmm. because he was right there where the involvement took place. And whether they respect him or not, he didn't give a shiggity. Mm-hmm. He was about civil rights and equality and good trouble. Good trouble, which they felt was bad trouble, which they still do today. And that's just a way of life, but his legacy has to live on. It can't die out. And sometimes our courage and our great leaders, their legacy will die to a point. But there's something that will happen that re-triggered, because look at the marches. They faded out. And that's all they're doing now. They still burning out cities and looting, but that's part of the reality of when it happens. There's gonna be that group that's what they after. But the real focus is on change the system so this doesn't have to happen anymore. But if it happens again, there's still gonna be burning down the buildings, there's still gonna be deaths, there's still gonna be prejudice, there's still gonna be people out there shooting at us, there's gonna be people shooting back, but I'm just hoping that it's not gonna be a civil war, a Confederate war between races in the states. Because like I said, there's black men 60, 70, 80 strong, they walking around with AK-15s too in the streets, protecting.
Go ahead, Celia.
I wanted to say something about John Lewis though. Also, you talked about his legacy, and the thing is, his legacy continued after his death because he submitted an editorial to the New York Times.
Yes.
And asked them to publish it when he died. And I don't know if you read that, and it was written to the people who are protesting now. Yeah. And, you know, I think with the media, the other thing is that there is focus on the negative, but there are people protesting in Portland and New York every day.
They're still out there in the streets. And that's what I make sure I keep myself in tune with what's going on. My grandchildren say all I do is sit around, Papa, why do you watch the news so much? Because I said, it's not entertainment like these TV shows that do nothing for you. This is about life. And what's going on right now is about changing life. And what they're doing will affect you. So I want to see about it every day. I thank you for my time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Alan, are you good?
Yes, I am. I really love that. Last part, we have people coming in. But the last thing I want to say is I love that. I wanted to ask you so bad. Lyndon McKinley. It good trouble? Was it necessary trouble?
It was necessary. Even back then in 71. I feel anything you're doing to try and move yourself forward for the better is good trouble.